In this first short video on the timeline of the late Republic, we're going to look at the beginnings of the problems. And actually, I'd like to start a little bit earlier than the mid-second century BC. In fact, I'd like us to start in 180 BC, when a law is introduced that gives strict age limits to the various magistracies of the Roman Republic. Now, this is interesting and important for the later period because it sets a limit of age and as to when you can progress through the various stages of the cursus honorum. Following the law introduced in 180, a very crucial point on the timeline is the sack of Carthage and indeed Corinth in 146. This is, for the Roman author Sallust, a turning point when Rome's morals decline and they no longer have external enemies to contend with. So this is, even in the Roman Republican period itself, considered a turning point. Following that, Appian, a later imperial writer, saw the tribunate of Tiberius Gracchus as a turning point, as a point when internal violence starts to infect the Roman Republic in 133 BC. Now, the tribunates of Tiberius and his younger brother Gaius are important for the major themes that historians see in the late Republic: the struggle of power between the Senate and the people, questions of land, questions of wealth and social equality. And this culminates in 121 BC with the death of Gaius Gracchus at the hands of the Senate. This is the first instance when the Senate decree what Julius Caesar would refer to as the ultimate decree of the Senate, the Senatus Consultum Ultimum. We see by the end of the second century BC that while Sallust saw the fall of Carthage as the end of great rivalries in the Mediterranean, Rome was still struggling with a number of overseas wars, fighting against Jugurtha in North Africa and facing the incursion of Germanic tribes from northern Italy. These wars took up much of Rome's resources and placed large amounts of power in the hands of Gaius Marius. The beginning of the first century BC not only saw the continuation of external wars, but what could almost be termed a civil war in Italy. This was the war of the Roman allies, the Italian communities, against Rome, due to a large part to the social and economic inequalities they had experienced since the time of the Gracchi and even before. Rome's allies rose up against Rome and tried to create an independent state of Italy. Whilst their attempts came to nothing, they did in the end gain Roman citizenship, widening the remit of who was Roman, creating a unified Italy, even though the social tensions that caused the war would continue further on through the period. Whilst Rome was contending with a war in Italy, it was also facing pressure from the east. The Pontic king Mithridates managed to stage a one-day attack across five major cities in Asia Minor that saw the death of between 80,000 and 150,000 Roman and Italian citizens. This gives us a sense of how much hatred there was for Roman control in the Eastern Mediterranean. And this prompted a series of wars against Mithridates that would start in 88 with Sulla and continue down until the 60s with Pompey. Whilst Rome was contending with Mithridates in the east in 88, and whilst it had ended the war with the Italians, a new war sprung up in Italy, this time a true civil war between Marius and Sulla. And the bone of contention was who was going to have command in the war against Mithridates. So we can start to see how all these things, external affairs and internal fighting, come together in a cataclysmic event which produces the first civil war in 88 BC.